and Sunday, and it turned upside like that. I said, oh no, everybody's gonna get a headache trying to watch you. I went and I straightened it out, but it was about 3 o'clock.
Thank you.
you all stand, please? All of you for coming today in remembrance of John. What a great young man he was. And it's a great loss for us, but it's a great gain for heaven. I remember talking with John several years ago, and he really impressed me. I've been here now about 27 years, and I hadn't been here but about a year or two, and I came into church one morning, and our mailbox across the street was knocked off the hinges and everything. It was laying out in the yard. Goodness, we'll have to put that back up. Within an hour, John was out there putting a brand new one up. And he admitted it. He came and said, "Preacher, I am so sorry. I lost it last night just a tad, and I was really coming down the road." Just like John, you know, he was a speed master. And he said, "Just barely clipped it, but boy, it looked like I hit straight over it, doesn't it?" And I said, "Well, you are an honest man." That's all I can say. You are a very honest man with integrity. And he fixed it. It's still over there, by the way. When you leave, you'll see it across the road. He put that up. But we thank you all for coming. I want to thank all of you for being here for this fine family we love so much. Christina, Bill, Dana, all the others here, and all the son-in-laws and their son. It's just Lincoln, I think. And he's going to be coming to speak in a moment. And then we thank all of you for being here. So let's have a word of prayer. Father, we just pray that you would just help us as we come together today to remember John. What a wonderful young man he was. He was a delight to be around. Always full of energy and always full of laughter and humor. And I pray you'll just bless the family here. I pray that God, every person that came today will get a strength and a help that only you can give, because, Lord, we're all weak, but we need your touch during these times especially. And so we pray that it would glorify Jesus Christ, and it would honor the memory of John and be a comfort to his family and friends. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. John Clarence Rayle, born December the 20th, 1973, went to heaven September the 3rd, 2021. He was, of course, born here in Greensboro to Billy and Ima Jean Harris Rayle. John's preceded in death by his mother, Ima Jean Harris Rayle, and his brother, Thomas Guy Rayle. And growing up, he loved to play outdoors. No doubt, right? He would ride anything with wheels on it and just run the wheels off. He was just a fine young man who loved the outdoors. Had a passion for riding, had a passion for working on cars, dirt bikes, motorcycles. I almost bought a motorcycle with him, and my wife wouldn't let me do it. I told Mr. Bill one day, I said, "You know, I'd sure like, I used to ride one when I was a little boy," nothing like he was going to sell it. He had a Honda Goldwing, but it had a few years on it. He was going to really give me a good deal. And Bill told me about it. He said, "I'll go over there with you." He said, "John will take care of you." And I went home, I told my wife, and I begged her. She said, "No, you can't have it. You'll never make it on it." I said, "Okay. Don't need trouble at home." But he was very nice, very generous, he and Bill both. And they really helped me a lot down through the years. In his younger years, he loved playing baseball, snow skiing, water skiing, riding, doing tricks on his jet ski at Bathing Lake. Later, he started racing motocross bikes. Became very good at motocross. He won many first place trophies, won the championship in 1998. His most recent favorite pastime was spent with his family riding bikes and their Polaris Razors. He graduated here from Southern Guilford High School in 1992, and after that, he went on to GTCC in Engineering Technologies. Went to work at his father's manufacturing business right down the road at Reed's Trailer. Then later, he pursued his passion. I remember when he opened up his motorcycle shop and ATVs, and he would work on them from sunup to sundown in half the night. And Superfly cycles and all in Burlington down there. After marrying the love of his life, starting his family, he sold his company, began his career Pressing Company Incorporated in Mebane as their quality specialist. John was a loving husband, father, son, brother, friend. No doubt we'll all miss him. Survived by his wife, Christina, their son, Lincoln, and father, Billy Rayle, sisters, Donna Hicks of Greensboro, Dana Shafe, and husband, Doug of Greensboro. And so what a fine family we have representing him. And he had a wonderful upbringing and a great heritage, and it showed. And so at this time, we're going to sing one of the family's favorite songs, or have it played for us, "On the Wings of a Snow White Dove."
Living trouble, so now name be sin. He won't forget. Sit down in love on the wings of a dove, on the wings of a snow.
Sons, and one of them was his best man when he was married there, and Christina, and so it's her son. He's going to come and he's going to read something very special that he wrote about John. And so, Forrest, that's your name, right?
Forrest. Yes, sir.
Forrest, would you come at this time? Mr. Forrest, thank you so much.
Strange, isn't it? Each man's life touches so many other lives. And when he isn't around, he leaves an awful hole, doesn't he?
Yes.
It's a quote from the 1946 movie, It's a Wonderful Life, and that character's name was Clarence. This classic Christmas movie has become tradition for so many families, and ours included. To our family, it's a film about discovering purpose in each person's life. It's a movie about appreciating each blessing you have. It's about committing a devout life of marriage with the right person. It's a wholesome film that John's life represented so well. John was our family mechanic and our caregiver. He was our landscaper and our healer. He was our farmhand and our provider. He filled so many roles with so much responsibility associated with each, and he did it all with genuine love. One day, Lincoln will understand what the late great Hank Williams Jr., also known as Bocephus, said about his own father. My daddy was somewhere between God and John Wayne. With the passing of John, we all lost some part of us. I thought to myself, how could I be better than before when a part of me had come to pass? And the answer is simple, and it's to be more like John. Some of the dearest memories I have of him that I want to share with everybody. Watching him pull a hot cookie sheet out of the oven with his bare hands. Hearing him frying bacon for breakfast before anyone else had risen. Seeing him always by Lincoln's side, answering all of his questions and watching so closely after him. We used to race dirt bikes every weekend, and he would always go slow over the jumps with us just so we could all figure out how fast to go to hit him. I heard stories of him on his jet ski and being rambunctious. Still can't believe the tricks he says he used to do on them. We would horseplay around the house, oftentimes chasing each other around in circles, which sounded like a stampede of bulls. He would let us punch him as hard as we could, and then would laugh in our face and say we could never ever hurt him. He would buy us dirt bike parts and teach us how to put them on. We tinkered with RC cars, anything with an engine, never taking it anywhere to get fixed. Christmas time, he would always make sausage balls and never give up his secret recipe that was on the back of the Bisquick box. He let me take his Dodge Magnum with 20 foes on it to my junior prom. Watching him cry during the sappy Hallmark movies, or him wearing a gold chain and a backwards hat, which forever influenced my choice of style. Listening to him talk about his work ethic in his elementary school life, where he would work on the farm before going to school. He would always send me videos of Colorado rock crawling or snowmobiles or dirt bike trails and always say, we gotta go there. I never thought I'd take any of those moments for granted. This time for eulogies to be uttered is a time for us folks to allow ourselves to enter a state of vulnerability. The lessons we get in these eulogies will serve us to give us hope and reopen ourselves to what we've decided to close our own doors to. The impact they create has the potential to make the living reevaluate the life we are living. The impact is not merely about rethinking their lifestyles. Instead, it's about reshaping our own lives by putting into consideration how things are perceived from a late friend, or lover, or family member, or even your enemy. If we all pick up where John left off, he would be proud. And this world will be a brighter and more joyous place to share with one another. In closing, I'd like to recite something from my best man's speech at John and my mom's wedding. John may have been the butt of a few jokes from Christina about what goes where and when, but I need to tell everyone about how great this man is. This curly-headed, percolator-loving, bad boy named Clarence, or Clarice, is an angel here upon us. He came into the lives of my brothers and I at such an interesting time. But this isn't about timing, because faith in the Lord teaches us that it's always right. Yes. He walked into a role that I'm sure he didn't expect, and he made us all happy beyond all belief. He's an enduring and sarcastically compassionate man of virtue that's blessed our lives with his presence alone. As my mom said in her vows, he's never one to hesitate. At a time when a father figure was needed, John stepped up. When my mom needed someone to lean on, John, you stepped up. And when it came to adding another link in the Rayle family chain, John stepped up and showed his ability to love harder than he has ever done before. Now he's raising Lincoln to be a leader and a wholesome man. I get to watch it all take place, and it's simply heartfelt. Simply put, John is a blessing to have in my life. His phone is constantly ringing with people seeking his advice, and he always keeps an open ear to listen to my mom. He's worked so hard to run a company, start a family, get engaged, raise a young man, start another new job, and he still rides bikes with Lincoln every day after school. He loves my mother dearly, and for that I will be forever grateful for you, John. So let's raise a glass and toast to keep an open heart. That means to give love to anyone seeking it, and to accept love from anyone willing to open their hearts to yours. I love you both so very much. And cheers. Thank you.
Beautiful. Thank you for that. And it did describe John very well. This time, we're going to have another song. Christina was telling me that nobody had ever sent her a song. And one day, John sent her a song. And she had never got over it yet. And it's called Beautiful Crazy. And that's a special song to her.
Day starts with a coffee, ends with wine, takes forever getting ready, so she's never on time for anything. When she gets that come get me look in her eye, well, it kind of scares me the way that she drives me wild. She drives me wild. Crazy, you can't help but
Actually new to the Rayle family. Been around about a year, Christina. I've had the privilege of meeting John maybe 10 times, but one of my favorite absolute memories of him, I'd always come to the barn to see Christina, and I was well known for crashing date night many, many times. I'd come, and John would just be like, "You want to come to dinner with us?" And I'd just crash date night, so that's one of my favorite memories about John. And he just really, he was the sweetest person ever, and he acted like he knew me forever. And I'm just very thankful to have met him, and I'm gonna do my best to keep Christina and Lincoln whole from a distance. I live in Lexington, so I'm about an hour from her, but I'm here, and I just wanna say thank you for allowing me.
And
it was a pleasure to know John.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Anybody else like to say a word? You'd like to come up, or you can just stand right where you are. You'd like to say something.
I'll never forget the first time I met John. I was at the bar with Christina, and he looked at me and he laughed and he said, "Aren't you the one to blame for all these rabbits sitting in this rabbit tree?" And I pretended I had no idea what he was talking about. And every day, at any time I'd see him at the barn, he'd ask me, "How many of these rabbits are you going to take home today?" And I remember one day I was at the barn, and Christina and Lincoln were both there. And John looked up, and he looked right at Christina. And the love he could see coming out of his eyes was so strong. I could feel it. It almost knocked me to the ground. It was shocking. And not a minute later, he looked over at Lincoln. And so much pride. he's just such an amazing young man. John was probably one of the nicest, most wonderful people you could ever meet. And there was a big hole in the moral battle that he was going, but he'll never be forgotten. Christina, Lincoln, I'm so sorry for your loss, but John is always there watching over the both of you.
Wanted to share a few things quickly. But as I thought about John, and as I mentioned earlier, I sat with him one time in the office back here, and we talked a little bit. I said, John, do you know for sure you're going to go to heaven one day? He said, yes, sir, I sure do, preacher. I said, how do you know? He said, I trust in Christ, who died for me, was buried and rose again. And I said, well, that's exactly what the Bible said you have to do. None of us are good enough to make it on our own. We're all sinners, all in the same boat. None of us can point at any of us, because there was only one who was perfect. That's Christ. And he had trusted him. So I thought about something in the Bible, very strange verse. Paul said this in Philippians 1:21, for me to live is Christ. But then he says, and to die is gain. And I thought, you know, death is such a sudden stop of life. What does he mean by that? What do you gain through death? I mean, it seems like we're just, you know, our whole heart has been torn apart in death of our loved ones. What did he gain through death? Well, the Bible teaches that he gained a better body. Now, John was no doubt a muscular, strong fellow. He took good care of himself. But we all know that we're living in a body of clay, made from the dust of the ground. And over the years, if you notice, everybody else is getting older except for you. When you look in the mirror, you say, I still look the same, but I don't know why everybody else is getting older. You know? We're really all getting older. And pretty soon, life is like a vapor. It's here one moment and it's gone. And that's the way life is. But in the resurrection and in going to heaven, the Bible says Jesus will give his children a body like he had. It passes through walls. It travels at the speed of sound. Never grows old. Never suffers any sickness. There's no COVID in heaven. No coronavirus. I mean, none of that. No cancer. Why? Because it's a perfect place. So we get a better body, and he's got a better body today. Get a better home. I know they have a beautiful home. But however beautiful the homes are that we see on this earth can never be compared to what Jesus said in John 14. Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And he said, I go and I'm going to prepare a place for you. And I go and prepare a place. And when I finish, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And the disciples couldn't quite understand that. And they said, how can we know the way? And he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And so Jesus prepared John's mansion in heaven, and he got it ready. And I really believe that's right out of the Bible. It's not a fairy tale. Straight out of the Bible. We also have a better fellowship when we get to heaven, because we all live in a dissolving family circle. I can still remember years ago, the first funeral I ever attended. It broke my heart as a little boy. And I could see that the people were crying, and I didn't quite understand everything, but it really did bother me to see those people in such agony. And then I found out really what death was when my grandmother died, and then my own mother died, and my sister, she died. And being a pastor, is just, your people are just like your own family, and after 27 years, you lose a lot of people, and it hurts. And yet, when we get to heaven, there's no separation. We're all going to enjoy each other's presence forever and ever and ever. And John, Paul said, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. And he said, I'm in a strait. That means he's in a dilemma. He said, I need to stay here on this earth to help train you. But he said, I want to go to heaven because that's where my rewards are. And then he went on to say this, absent from the body is present with the Lord. The body will lay down, but the soul lives forever. John lives forever. This is only his earthly tabernacle that he lived on this earth in. But John is more alive than he's ever been. And he will be there waiting to ride a motorcycle with you if you like to ride one. That's just what the Bible teaches. And so you get a better fellowship. You get a better reward. It's only beyond the gates of death when you hear Jesus say, well done, good and faithful servant. And as you heard the testimonies, John was a good and faithful servant of the Lord and of his family, of his friends. Kind of reminds me, I heard about a preacher one time, and he had a little boy who was sick, and he got deathly sick, and the preacher spent all his money, and his little boy got sicker and sicker, and finally, after it got pretty crucial, they were sitting there one night on the couch, and the little boy looked up at daddy, and they'd sit there and watch the TV every night together. He would treasure those moments with his son, and he would say, daddy, and this time, he said, daddy, what does it feel like to die? He had heard him over talking. And he broke his heart, and he let a tear in his eye. Then God gave him some wisdom. As a preacher, he said, son, it's kind of like this. We sit here every night, and we watch TV together. And you fall asleep in my arms, and I pick you up, and I take you to your room. And you wake up the next day, and you don't know how you got there. But guess what? You're there in your nice, warm room, and I carried you up there. And he said, one day, when our life is over on this earth, Jesus will come for us, and he'll escort us across the gates of heaven, and we'll be with him forever and forever. And John loved his son. He loved all of his sons. I know he told me that, and his wife, and all of his family and friends. But when I think about all the love that John had, it reminds me of a grandfather who loved his grandson so much that he came over to visit his grandson one day, and his grandson had been misbehaving. So the father's daughter was the mother of the grandson, and he walked in the door, and the little boy was in a playpen. And he looked and saw his grandpa come through the front door, and he said, out, Gramps, out, give me out. And he said, sure. And he went over there, and it tucked on his heart. He reached down to grab his grandson, pull him out of the playpen. All of a sudden, the mother said, no, Daddy. He's misbehaved. I've got to teach him that he's got to do right. So there was the problem. Love and grace and the law. The law. She had laid down the law, and he had done something she didn't like. And so she was trying to teach him there are consequences. So here's the grandfather, and he's torn in two, and he doesn't know what to do. And he looked at that little boy, and his heart's just crying out for him. But then he looked at his daughter, and he understood because he did it a few times with his daughter, and said, you know what he did? He reached down and took his shoes off, took his socks off, and got in the playpen with his grandson. And that illustrates what Jesus did for us. He's God, King of kings and Lord of lords, and yet he humbled himself, became a man, came down to this earth and lived 33 years, never said a bad word, never did a bad deed, and yet he died for us. He wasn't dying for himself, a humble man, much like John. Christina told me he was scared to have any children because he didn't feel like he could be a good daddy. And I thought, goodness, if anybody could be a good daddy, it's John. And that's the way Christ was. He humbled himself to death so that we could come to Christ and be saved. What a blessing that is. Let's bow our heads in prayer and heads about. Maybe today you are here today and you would like to know this same Savior that John knew. I know John would rejoice knowing a family member or a friend came to know his Savior at his memorial service. I would never come to you, call your name out, or embarrass anyone. I don't do anything like that, but it's a private decision. But everybody has to make it. What are we going to do with the Savior? What are we going to do with Christ? He loved us. He died in our place. He was buried. He rose again. He's alive. And he said, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you'd like to call on Christ today, in your heart, you can pray silently if you'd like. But would you, if you really want to make sure you're going to go to heaven, would you in your heart pray something like this? Dear Jesus, I receive you as my Savior. Thank you for dying on that cross just for me. Help me to live for you, Lord. Make me a home in heaven. And our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. And again, the Bible said there is joy in the presence of the angels over one person who comes to Christ. I'm not going to come to you and embarrass you, but I want to pray for you. If you made that decision, I want to congratulate you and say you made the best decision you could ever make. You'll see him again. You did exactly what he did. So while our heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if you would like for me to pray for you today and you ask Christ to be your Savior, would you just look up for one moment and then you can put your head down. God bless you, sir. Thank you for that. God bless you. Thank you. Father, we thank you for these who have put their faith in Christ. And Lord, help us to tell others the wonderful news of Christ. Father, we know that John is reunited with his brother, a well-remembered guy. And I know he is reunited with his mother. I well remember Jeannie. What a blessing they were to us. And all the others who have gone and preceded him. And Lord, one day we'll see him and we'll go. But I pray that you'll bless these here today. Comfort and strengthen each one. Bless those that made that wonderful decision. I know John's rejoicing in heaven over that. We'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. This time, we'll have a song, I Will See You Again. And that's got a great message.
I feel you walking.
we're going to see him again. I want to close with an actual quote from John. Dana shared this with me. See if this doesn't sum him up in his own words. I love the outdoors and the feel of speed. I live to fly. That's why they call me Superfly. Oh yeah, and I'm really cool too. That's what John said. Thank you so much. Let's close in prayer, and then we'll have the family go out, and you can follow them out under the tent and show them your condolences. Thank you again for all of you coming today. What a wonderful tribute, a wonderful crowd. Father, we come again to ask your blessings upon us as we come together. I pray, God, you protect us all, and yet I pray that we would also be a strength for this family. They need our prayers, they need our presence, and they need our encouragement. And then we just pray that you'll bless everyone here today. Give us a good week and be with Christina. And I pray that God, you'll be with Bill and Dana and Donna and all their families, Lord. I know it's an awful, tough thing to lose a brother or a son or a husband. So we pray, God, you would fill the void and they would know your touch in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand, please? Thank you.